Life is about experiences. The good ones, and the not so good ones. Our experiences are what gives our lives meaning. They become our memories. They make us who we are. So tell me, have you experienced Jesus in your life? The greatest experience of all.
Hi, my name is Dave Bartosiewicz, and I'm host of the show, Have You Experienced Jesus? You know, I put the show together because I think there are a lot of people out there who might go to church or might not even go to church, but don't really know who Jesus is. He is so much bigger than we know, and he's so much more mysterious. He is really God in flesh. But the great thing about this is that we have a lot of witnesses and testimonies that are coming up, sharing their heartfelt feelings about who Jesus is and why they love him so much. I mean, he brings the good news for us. This good news is so important for us to understand because he gives us the robe of righteousness so that we who believe in what he did on the cross, that he paid for our sins, that he gives us this robe and it covers us. And by it covering us, we are made righteous through our belief. You know, religion says do, 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 do. I want you to do this, I want you to do this, I want you to do this. And if you don't do this, you're really not made worthy or righteous. Jesus says, he says this, it's done. I've done it. Now come to me through your belief and faith, and then you will be made righteous. That's the great news. His news is so important to us because it gives us freedom. This new experience of life, we're not based on laws anymore. And you're going to see a lot of witnesses and believers, all different flavors, all different types of people. You know, I call them flavors like ice creams, from vanilla to Rocky Road and in between. These are individuals who really are unique and different, but have a personal relationship with Jesus because they believe in what he did. And the Holy Ghost comes now down into their body and rest in them every day. And never leaves. That's a great thing about us because we are made children of God. He's our rescuer, our redeemer, and our God who saves. Praise God for Jesus. I hope you enjoy these witnesses and testimonies of people who truly are born again. They really have given me a lot of understanding of belief and faith. Praise God for them. Enjoy the show.
Well, Casey Kelly, I'm here with Casey. He's pretty well known throughout the area. He certainly is a big believer in Jesus Christ. So I've met you, Casey, about 2 years ago.
Yeah.
I believe at The Rock,
yes,
which is a great church. I desire to show a lot of different believers throughout the state of Utah because I know that The Rock, which is, as I have said many times, is a different flavor. It's like a Rocky Road flavor compared,
sure,
to all these other flavors. You might have vanilla, you might have chocolate, you might have peach,
yeah,
but The Rock is, as I have said in the past, a rocky,
yeah,
road,
yeah,
full of great things going on.
Yeah.
As you can see, the diversity in you,
sure,
I love the fact that you have so many tattoos.
Yeah.
I love the fact that you pursue God,
yeah,
with all your heart, and I've seen your worship and how you worship Jesus, and it's amazing. But anyway, the show is called Have You Experienced Jesus? And I'm so glad to be here. I'm usually at homes, but I know that we couldn't go to your home because you have an office. You're an entrepreneur.
Yeah, most days.
That's right. And I'm glad to be here that I could share you with the audience.
Yeah.
So what I wanted to ask you, first of all, is how have you experienced Jesus in your life? How did it all happen for you? Love to hear your story.
Yeah, approximately 5 years ago, I was pursuing my own dreams, trying to be a rock star. I was trying to glorify myself, if you will. Prior to that, about 12 years old, I had began going to the LDS church. My family was not Christians or believers. They would be more agnostic or atheist. My father hated God, and my mom said, oh, there's a God, but I don't know what that looks like. And I remember as a young kid, we had some missionaries come over, and she took the Book of Mormon and threw it in a fireplace and said, that's what religion's about, should be in a fire. And it was kind of a weird world for me as a young 8-year-old kid seeing that, going, I don't know what that looks like. And you know, kind of transpired where I began going to the LDS church for a while. I had some questions. I was involved in, you know, scout groups and just mission opportunities and things. And kind of for me, I had some struggles and questions about certain doctrinal issues, right? And sometimes when it was brought up, often they'd say, "We'll pray about it. If you don't believe it, then maybe you should leave." And that was some of the responses I got. Now, I know that's not the common response across all of the denominations, but for me particularly, I didn't find that to be truth, or things that I didn't find truth in some of those things. And so I began searching out truth even more, and so much so where it brought me to a point where I was my own God, right? I could do my own thing. I'd run my own world. Rock and roll was my God, right? I believed in rock and roll and, you know, drugs, sex, alcohol. That was my life. You know, I stayed away from a lot of drugs. I didn't do any of that. You know, I did do some silly, stupid alcohol for a minute there, but it was only to impress stupid people that I don't really care about anyways, right? And then girls, you know, girls was my downfall and my sin in my life, right? And so for me, the biggest thing was coming out of that world. Up until about 5 years ago, I was about to go on a 6-month tour. We were recording a record. You know, I want to be a rock star. I'm following this big Warped tour. We have all these shows booked. I have labels looking at my band. And, you know, it was just the climax, right before the takeoff, if you will.
And how old are you at that time?
I was 17, 18.
Okay.
So, you know, so I'm 24 now. So yeah, I was right on the verge of turning 18 years old. And so I eat, sleep, and breathe it. I had four or five dudes in a band. We lived in a house 6 days a week. We'd practice all day long in order to make money. Not proud of it. We'd steal out of cars and make rent. You know, I had nothing. I was a low-life criminal just trying to be a rock star.
And wow.
I honestly didn't. Yeah, go ahead. What were you gonna
say? So what happened? You know, obviously yeah. You were going through that sort of worldly experience.
Yeah.
What turned your heart to come to Jesus?
Yeah, really it was a man named Steele Crosswhite. So Steele is an awesome man. He goes to the Rock Church. He actually is one of the pastors at the Rock. And at the time,
great guy.
The best thing that I found is that, you know, Steele said, "I love three things in my life, Casey: Jesus Christ, my wife, and rock and roll." And in my mind, I went, "I don't care about this Jesus guy, right? Your wife, my parents are swingers and they slept with other people, so I don't even know what marriage looks like. And rock and roll, we got one thing in common. Let's write a record, right?" And Steele actually was the producer of my band's album. So I hired Steele because he was known in the area to produce local bands, or Christian or non. And so we hired him because he was very professional with his ability to record. And so we hired him to record our record to go on tour. Well, in studio, God had different plans. You know, for the couple months prior to the recording of the studio, I had met a lot of my favorite rock stars. I had toured with them and I got to go behind the scenes and hang out with them. And I found that they just weren't people I wanted to be like, right? They were living this worldly life. And up front, they looked like men you wanted to be like, famous and rock star, on tour, girls, and everything you want, right? Just glory, thousands of people watching you and cheering your name.
Wow.
And I just found those people behind the scenes were strung out, drug addicts, lonely, hurt, empty, and they had nothing. Not every one of them, but most of them. And it was a bummer to me because I go, is this the life I'm gonna be living? You know, because yeah. I was playing shows for 1,000 kids, you know, 1,500 kids. At every show, they'd show up. And then what I'd find is, it was just empty.
Wow.
And so Steele, in studio, I said, "Steele, there's something about you that I just don't have, right? You got passion, you're like Jim Carrey on speed. I don't know, you're just a hyperactive, outgoing guy."
And honestly, he is, I've seen him.
Right? Yeah, he is. And I asked Steele, I said, "What is it that you have that I don't, man?" And he said, "Jesus, let me tell you about him." And I said, "Fine, I'll listen," right? Because I need something different than this crazy life that I'm living. And it just, there's no hope. And so Steele took me aside. He shared what we know as the diagram, right? God and man, separation. Jesus bridges the gap through his death, burial, and resurrection. We can have life in him if we confess our sins and believe in the life and the fullness of Christ. And that day I prayed to receive Christ in my life. And within a week I lost my band, my girlfriend, my house. I tried to get it all back. I came home, my band's partying, my girlfriend's sleeping with other guys, my house is just trashed, and I felt like God audibly spoke to me, Casey, are you going to be a man who follows after me, or are you going to be a man who chases after glory, fame? And honestly, that day I said, "No, God, I want to honor you." You know, I moved in with my mom, I got a $9 an hour job, I sucked it up, I bought my first $500 beater with a heater, and I just started working hard. And that was about 5 years ago, until, you know, fast forward present day, right?
Yes.
I have a business. We've grown to 7 retail locations. God's really blessed us in a mighty way. I'm married, been married almost 4 years to a beautiful woman, Amanda. I've got a daughter who's 16 months old and another baby on the way.
Wow, congratulations.
It's a radical world transformation of experiencing Jesus. I mean, I am the epitome of God taking a wretched sinner and making a saint, you know, by his grace.
Oh, praise God. Praise God. So when you're looking now and you look at just in 4 or 5 years, this all has happened.
Yeah.
Is Jesus everything to you?
He is. He's everything. I can't wait to be there with him, you know, in heaven. Honestly, I mean, this life is but a breath. We're in the tent in this body, right? I can't wait to get to heaven, to an eternal dwelling where there's no more pain and no more sin and no more sadness and no more struggle. And, you know, in a world of entrepreneurism, in a world of chaos, in a world of trying to lead and lead churches, I mean, I do small group and bands and music. It's so hard to balance all of it. And sometimes I find myself like, God, when are you just coming back? I mean, tomorrow? I mean, well, just let me know. let me know when you're coming back so I can just rest a little bit. And I try to find that peace today and go, you are coming back. I'm going to live like you're coming back in 100 years and honor you, but I'm going to expect you to come back tomorrow and be faithful to the end.
So. Oh, great. So you have all the hope.
I do. Lots of hope.
That's terrific.
It's, yeah, the joy of the Lord is my strength, as the Bible tells me.
Well, one of the things that I've seen, you are an incredible worship leader. You have a great band. I have seen you. I've seen how you put your heart and your faith and your trust in Him and Him alone. Yeah. Is there anybody between you and Him?
No, you know, there's no one between Jesus and I. There's things that can come between Jesus and I, right? Such, you know, for me for so long, because music was my life. I mean, I was militant about it, right? It was like, I am the army of music, and that's what I was going to do. 6 days a week, we only rested so we could learn new songs, right? That's the world I lived in. And so coming in, even playing worship music, as you referenced, at a church, right? It's like, there's no glory in being a musician at a church, if you will, right? Now, The Rock has, as you know, the flavors. We got 15 bands, we got the rock music, we've got all kinds of musical-oriented things, because that's a big part of our ministry, right? Whereas some people have coffee, some people have certain sermons or preachers, and we have rock and roll, right? That's just what we do. But the thing in that is that it can almost become its own idol. There's that balance, and it's definitely good to have accountability, such as Steele or other pastors, to go, brother, that was the old ways. This is not that way. You know, you're not going to make $1 million recording Christian records, because that's not the heart of it. The heart is to give away 1 million records and hope to see people come to Jesus.
Exactly. I think that's the key in the movement of the Christian music that you're seeing. And it's happening all over now. Have you noticed that?
Totally. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of great bands out there that I really appreciate. Bands Sanctus Real and Casting Crowns. I mean, these bands that I would have never listened to personally, right, prior, where most of my music was hardcore music. So I didn't like, you know, 4/4, perfect melodic beats. Yeah, I didn't care about that stuff, right? I just cared about like heavy breakdowns, and God just changed my heart and goes, no, I'm going to make a simple song where, you know, I lift my hands to worship you, you know, praise God. It's like all these songs, how great is our God? I will jam a Chris Tomlin record all day long, four chords or not.
I'm going to go see Chris May 1st down in Phoenix.
That's awesome.
So yeah, very excited about that. Yeah. We did have about 30 seconds left, 30 or 40 seconds left. What would you recommend for people who don't know Jesus? What would you recommend that they could do?
Get your Bible. Get a Bible. Read it. Get a good version of the Bible. I would recommend NIV, NLT, ESV. Some people beat me up for that, right? But those are some of the Bibles I like to read. One thing I would say is start in the book of John, right? The Gospel of John. There's four Gospels, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John, right? Start in John and just start reading about Jesus, man, because it talks about His love, His passion. He cares for you. Just read John over and over again, because if you don't get Jesus in John, you're not going to get in the rest of it. And pray for God to change your heart, because if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is the Lord and the Father raised Him from the dead, you will not perish, but you will have eternal life.
Praise God. Well, you know, I just want to thank you so much for this opportunity. Obviously, you're a strong believer in Jesus. I've witnessed that, and I'm sure many people today witness how strong you are with Christ. Amen. Thank you so much
for
this time. You bet. Bye-bye.
Hi, my name is Lane Howes with Major Mortgage in Clearfield, Utah. Specializing in FHA, VA, and conventional, whatever your needs may be, whether it's buying a new house, an existing house, or purchasing or even streamlining an FHA or VA loan, I'm here to help you from the beginning to the end. Not the type of loan officer that says hello to you, takes your application, and then you never see me. I'm the loan officer that starts in the beginning, walks you through the middle, and then sits with you in the closing at the closing table. Again, we'd love to help you with the rates at 40-year lows today. Come on down to my office, set up an appointment, give me a call, whatever it takes. 801-390-7450. We're specializing in these loans in Idaho, Arizona, Texas, Colorado, and here in lovely Utah. Again, we'd love to hear from you. Give me a call today, 801-390-7450. Hope to talk to you real soon.
I am just so grateful for being here and actually having you share your witness and testimony of Jesus Christ, who I know that is very, very important to your life.
Yes, He is.
The most important, I believe, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I know your story. I know your heart with Jesus. And one of the things I wanted to do was let the audience know who you really are with Him. The show is called Have You Experienced Jesus? The question I have for you is, how have you experienced Jesus?
So many ways. As a child, I just loved Jesus. I was born in the Catholic Church, baptized a Catholic. For some reason, I was shielded from a lot of things that were in the church as far as rules and regulations, but my heart just wanted to seek after Jesus. But as a child, I just wanted more, and when I was baptized, and then I was also had First Holy Communion at a very young age when I was like six, which that doesn't normally happen, but we were overseas with my dad being in the Air Force. And then I had confirmation like within a week later, and I was probably six or seven. And they asked me, they said, now you're a soldier of Christ. And I thought, wow, this is really cool. I'm this little soldier. And it was, you know, I loved Jesus, but I didn't know him to the extent I do now, because it's a journey with him. It's a walk with him, and you become closer to him. You come into the chambers of his heart, the older, wiser, I don't know if you want to say that, but the more you walk with Christ, you become so intimate with him. But to go back a little bit, there was one experience that I had when I was probably a sophomore in high school, and my mom was an alcoholic, so I went through a lot of hard experiences as a child. But through that, I believed that Jesus, I was experiencing his love for me, because he was always there protecting me. Even though I felt like nobody was there at times, he was always there. And one particular night, my mother had said something very cruel, and I had had it. And so I walked out, and I almost walked in front of a car and wanted to end my life. So when I got back home, this guy drove me back home that had seen it happen. So as I got back home, I went to bed that night and in tears, as I normally did. And my mother had a habit of flipping the lights on when she would come into our room and just start ranting and raving. And at that point, I said, Father, it was like I didn't want to live anymore. So I just said, why have you forsaken me, as Jesus did? And I thought, okay, this is very strange, because a light came into my room. And as this light was in my room, I saw hands. And at first I got very scared, because I thought, oh no, he's coming to get me and I'm going to die. But I looked at him and I couldn't see his face. There was this brightness that I could not really look at, but all I saw was his hands. Mm. And there was a sash on his waist, and it was like liquid. Radiance. I can't explain it. And his voice said, Jeanie, I love you.
Wow.
I love you, and I will never leave you or forsake you. And then it was gone. And then I thought, okay, I'm dreaming, man. It must have been some pizza or something, but it really wasn't. So I forgot about that experience as I grew older. I remembered it, but it wasn't something that I really shared with anybody, because I thought they would think I was nuts. So through my growing experiences and through my life, I went through a lot of different stages in my life. And I had gotten to a point when I married Frank. I was seeking, we were in New Jersey, and I was still in the Catholic Church.
I see.
And I would go to prayer meetings. And the prayer meetings were so amazing, because they were, I have to back up a little bit. I had gone to what they call a Life in the Spirit seminar in about 1970, I want to say three, somewhere okay. around there. And I became born again at that point.
So how were you born again? What happened?
Well, I went through this Life in the Spirit seminar, and then they just basically asked me, do you really know who Jesus is and what he did for you? And I had that always in my head, being raised. I knew what Jesus died on the cross for me. He took my sins, but it became real to me at that point. It was like I understood that he really loved me and that he did what he did for me. And if I was the only person, he would have done it for me. And it wasn't because I had to do anything. It was because he loved me. And loving was like something I needed in my heart. So I really connected with that love of God, the grace, the security, because I had a lot of fear. So anyways, as I was going through this, I just grabbed a hold of it. I didn't want to let go of God. And so my journey started at that point with knowing Christ and experiencing him, because I wanted a deeper walk with him.
Okay. And so from that time forward to today, what has transformed in your life? Now, I know that you study the word every day.
you're very committed to Jesus. You love his word with all your heart. What kind of things have changed in your life from that moment? And how dedicated are you to Jesus?
I can't live a day without him. I cannot go a day without being with him, knowing. I walk with him every day. Every second, actually, I think of him. I used to drive my kids crazy because I would say, look, there's, you know, something beautiful in that. Jesus, God made that. And so God was in my life all the time. So the more at this point in my life is the, I want to call the be still and know that I am God. It's that sweet presence of God, of just being in his presence in the chambers of his heart, to know him and to become more intimate with him and his love for me and for other people. And through that, I worship. I worship him in my singing, in my decorating, no matter what I do.
Because, in prayer.
In prayer, because yeah. I'm an intercessor.
You are.
Intercessor prayer is a beautiful thing because you pray for people. Jesus is the intercessor, the great intercessor, and because he died on the cross and he interceded for us to the Father to bring us life because of his shed blood on that cross. And when he did that, he said, it's finished. So for me...
What does that mean, that it's finished?
That it was done. I don't need to do anything anymore. I really don't have to impress him. I don't have to impress other people. I don't have to keep a set of rules and regulations, because none of us can keep the 12 commandments, because they're there to show us that we can't.
The 12 commandments?
The 10 commandments. Why did I say 12?
No problem.
I said 12.
I hope there's no more.
No, there's no more. Sorry, 10. You know, it shows us the first two are honor, you know, to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and spirit. So for me, if you don't do that first one and love God, I mean, love people as your, you know, as yourself, then you're breaking all the rest of them, because it just falls to suit, because you're not going to steal from your neighbor if you love God.
Do you think there's a big problem with that? A lot of people just follow the Ten Commandments and don't know truly the law of Jesus.
Okay.
Do they get it right when they think that way?
I think that if they follow the law, they will be miserable, because that doesn't give you freedom. And there's freedom in Christ.
Okay.
Because the love is the freedom. Because of his love, he took it all for us. So there's nothing we need to add to that. There's nothing we need to do. It's done. The work, they call it the finished work of the cross. So when you realize, if I say to myself, oh, well, no, I have to do this because if I don't, God's not going to love me. Well, then I'm saying that he hung on that cross for no reason at all, because I have to somehow make up for what he didn't do. And that's almost blasphemy. I mean, it is for me to realize that. And it hurts my heart to think that I would do that to the Lord.
Okay. Interesting. So when we're looking now, you got about a minute left.
Okay.
What are some of the key things that you would like to share for those people who don't know Jesus? What would you recommend?
That if they look around, God has put eternity in everybody's hearts. And if they really seek their heart and hear God is speaking to them every day to bring them to his heart, and that they would seek out that relationship with him, because it's not about a religion. It's not about a denomination. He loves you, and he desires you, you personally, and your heart. And through that, he will then take you like a masterpiece and create you and your giftings and everything that you have in your life to honor him and to bring him glory.
Beautiful. Exactly. And that's, I think, where a lot of people believe the same thing. We give him glory every day through how we walk, how he directs us, for those people
that's
who
right.
don't know him and or might need help, like what you do. You do prayer for a lot of people. It's amazing when you understand truly God and his purpose for us. Well, praise God. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
You're welcome.
Thank you so
it's
much
for
allowing
me. It's an honor to serve God and to, you know, be able to share. Thank you.
Praise God. Thank
okay.
you. Hi, this is Dave. I just want to thank both Jeanne as well as Casey for being a part of the show tonight. They did a terrific job. They have such witnesses of Jesus Christ, their Lord and their Savior. As you can see, they're different flavors. Certainly Casey is very different than Jeanne, but we look at them and we don't judge at all, because we love them, and we appreciate who they are. We appreciate their conviction and their devotion to Christ. And they certainly have that. One of the things I really want to express today is I want to express who Jesus is, how he is considered as Christians, as a body. We believe that he is obviously the Son of God. There's many different understandings of who Jesus is, but we also know that he is our prophet. In Luke 24:44, Jesus declares, he says, "Then he said to them, 'These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me.'" We know that Jesus came to fulfill the law and the prophets. Luke 16:16 says, "The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God has been preached and everyone is pressing into it." Hebrews 1:1-2 says, "God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son." We know that now God in the past would speak to the prophets, but now it is only through his Son. It's only through his Son that he speaks. And John 6:14 says, "Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, 'This is truly the prophet with the big P, who is to come into the world.'" We know that Jesus now is our prophet. His words that he gave us are in the New Testament. And so we have his words. We have his understanding. We know how to get saved. We know that he is the new covenant. We used to go and live by the first covenant with Moses as God revealed and gave the law to Moses. But we could never be made perfect through that. We knew that this is more of a checklist, and if we broke one of those laws, we broke the entire law. Now we go through the new covenant, which Christ spilt his blood and paid for all our sins. And so now the new covenant is his blood, that we are covered with his blood for salvation by believing in the work on the cross and what he did and that he paid for our sins. It's not about us trying to prove to God that we have to do works of righteousness to get into heaven. It's only through his work and through our belief. And once we understand that, we do good works all throughout our lives of righteous ways. And that's what we do. And so we're called to that, but those works do not give us salvation. The faith and the belief in what he did on the work does. I pray that you understand that. Galatians 5:1 says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage." So we don't go back to the law and try and do the checklist. We go through him and him alone, and we love him, we praise him, we give him our lives, and now we live a life of joy and peace and liberty. That's what it's all about. I hope that you preach the good news. This is the good news of the gospel. Have a great week, and God bless, and remember that God loves you.